I will now introduce Mr. William Uttenden, who is representing BioNTAP. He obtained his Master of Science in Chemistry at the University of Ghent with a thesis on polymer-reinforced peptide hydrogels for drug delivery. Since 2018, he's a research scientist in the textile coating and finishing at Centexbel, the Belgian Textile Research Center. He focuses mainly on bio-based materials and melt processing techniques for textile coating. And he will deliver the presentation, water-based PHA dispersion for coating and prints. So please, William, the floor is yours.
Yes, thank you very much. So I will give a presentation indeed on water-based PHA formulations for coating and printing. So I will start my presentation with a short introduction about Centexbel and who we are. And I will then continue about PHA, what is PHA, and how do we use it in a coating. So first of all, Centexbel, who are we? So Centexbel is a Belgian competence center for the textile and plastic converting industry. So the goal of Centexbel is to really be an industry-driven organization where we work both for and with the industry. In total, we have about 180 staff spread over three different locations in Belgium. The activities of Centexbel, there are quite a few. They include, for a large part, research projects, for example, the BioNTAP projects, for which I am giving this talk. But we also do quite a lot of testing and some services, for example, consulting. So for our testing laboratories, we have a number of accredited laboratories. This goes from a microbiology lab that, for example, tests the mouth masks, a physical lab that does a large number of physical tests on both plastics, but also a lot of textiles. We have a chemical lab to look, for example, for certain chemicals that might be present both in chemicals and plastics. And then a fire lab to scan the fire behavior of certain materials. For example, as you can see here, if a cigarette will make a seat get lit on fire. Then at Centexbel, we also have a number of services. So we use the testing laboratories I showed before to deliver a number of certifications. This goes, for example, for CE labeling, but also some textile-specific labeling, for example, Ucotex and a number of others. Then in the research, we have multiple research groups here at Centexbel crossing the whole value chain of textiles. So we start with the thermoplastic processing of the yarn, so of the polymers into yarns. Then we have a group on how to process the yarns, how to coat them, how to modify their surface once they are processed into yarn or once we have a textile. Then we can also look into research topics on health, safety and security of textiles and related articles. And because of the close relation with textiles, we also have a lot of research on plastic processing, so different techniques looking into recycling bio-based materials. This talk will be mainly about me and the work I did regarding the textile functionalization and surface modification, so different coatings that have been applied in this case on PHA. So I have been talking about PHA quite a bit already, but the question now is, what exactly is PHA and why is it such a novel and such a powerful new polymer? So first of all, PHA, it's not just one type of polymer. It's actually quite a large group of polymers of different types of polyhydroxyalkanoates. These polyhydroxyalkanoates, or for short PHAs, are actually bacterial polymers made by certain organisms. And they don't always produce this. They produce this when they have in their surroundings a high abundance of carb, for example, oils or sugars, and a low availability of other nutrients. And in these conditions, they will start to store these high abundance of oils and sugars in their cells as small granules of polymers. In this case, a polyhydroxyalkanoate. Because this is made by bacteria, There will be, of course, a difference based on the strain of bacteria. And here we can see this in the type of polymer. There will be different types of monomers that are used depending on the strain of the bacteria and the conditions in which the PHA has been made. Afterwards, then the PHA can be extracted and then used as a thermoplastic and bio-based polymer. So the advantage of this material is that, like I said, it is thermoplastic. It can be reworked and processed quite easily. The biggest advantage of PHA is that it degrades extremely fast. So it has very fast biodegradation, not just in soil, but in multiple environments, for example, the marine environment as well. All of this means that for these polyhydroxyalkanoates, there are quite high expectations from the industry to see what is possible with these materials. However, because they are so novel, there is currently quite a low availability. So how can PHAs exactly be produced? So as I said, they are produced when there is an abundance of sugars or oils in the environment. But these can actually be quite a large range of sugars or oils. This can go, for example, from waste oils, but also marine biomass that can be converted, hemicellulose. So a large range of materials, which means that there are actually multiple different types of PHA, not just in chemistry, but also in source. So you can have primary source PHA that is, for example, made directly from sugars that can be, for example, extracted from corn. But you can also go from waste streams and use those to extract or to produce PHA. I will then continue on how we use PHA, this really novel material, and how we use it to make different coatings or prints. So first of all, the way we apply prints or coatings using PHA is using the plastisol process. So a plastisol is in the textile industry a well-known process for PVC, where a PVC powder is mixed with a plasticizer. This forms a kind of paste, and this paste can then be applied as a coating. And when heated, the plasticizer will get absorbed into the PVC and form a smooth gelled coating. So what we try to do is look at a similar process, but this time with PHA instead of with PVC. So in this plastisol coating, we have, like I mentioned, similar to PVC, first of all, the PHA powder. So these powders come straight from the synthesis. So PHA can either be sold as granules or as powders. In general, these granules have already been processed because the small particles of PHA that are present in the bacteria cause it to be synthesized directly as a powder. We then did a very large screening on which plasticizers are compatible, both with PHA, but also with PLA. And then look what are the properties of the final coating depending on the plasticizer. Unlike PVC, where you only need the PVC and a plasticizer, here we also need water to ensure the smooth flow of the coating. The reason is that with PVC, the particle size of a PVC powder is much times smaller than that one in a PHA, which is why we need to add some water to add the flow into the formulation. And then in the end, if we combine these with some pepper and some salt to get to the perfect properties, we obtain a plastisol formulation that we can use in coating and printing. So this formulation can be used, as I said, both in direct coating, where we apply a coating on top of a substrate. This can be textiles, but this can also be, for example, a paperboard, as mentioned in previous presentations. What we can also use it for is screen printing. So we can, for example, make bio-based and biodegradable labels for a number of applications. So what happens now, once we have this formulation, we can apply it on a substrate, in this case a textile, but then what happens? So when we cure this substrate, we will first heat it to about 110 degrees. This will cause the water to evaporate from the formulation, which leaves behind the PHA and the plasticizer on top of the substrate it is applied on. Then we go for a second step where we heat up the material to about 180, 190 degrees. And here the material will start to fuse. So the plasticizer will get absorbed into the PHA and you will start to get a coating. A picture of this here can be seen on the left, where the PHA particles have been somewhat fused with the plasticizer. However, a smooth coating surface is not yet formed. To get a smooth surface, we need to do a third step where we either use a heat press or a calendar, essentially some way to apply both pressure and heat at the same time to fully fuse the PHA and the plasticizer into a smooth layer. As you can see here on the right, there is a drastic improvement after this step, which takes about 30 seconds with us at lab scale. So here you can see the coating applied on a linen fabric. If we then continue to the properties, so what are the properties of these different types of coatings? So we did a number of tests, both on PHA, that was combined with an increasing amount of plasticizer. But we also decided to look at what happens if we would blend a PHA and a PLA, or just look at a pure PLA. So when we look at a coating of PHA with plasticizer and we look at the abrasion resistance, this is measured with a Martindale. So you can see the Martindale equipment here on the right. So to do an abrasion resistance test using Martindale, we take a small sample of textile and we rub it with, in this case, wool for a certain number of cycles. So this is a specific pattern. So every part of the surface you want to test gets an even coverage or gets rubbed in the same way. So this is done with a standardized pressure. For this test, we used the 9 kilopascal, and this was then tested and analyzed every 10,000 seconds. We had a look what happens to the coating. So we can see for the first three samples of PHA, where we used a balanced amount of plasticizer, we get an extremely good result for this abrasion resistance. So 100,000 cycles is basically where we stop the test because we expect there is no more difference, or there is no more need to go further when looking at practical applications. So this is really excellent abrasion resistance for these PHA plastisol coatings. However, you can see in the fourth one that when we mix too much plasticizer with the PHA, here we're talking about more than 60% plasticizer, we really start to suffer on the abrasion resistance because of the high amount of plasticizer.
Excuse we can me, also combine. You have 5 yes. minutes left. Thank you.
Yes, perfect. So when we combine PHA and PLA, we see that the abrasion resistance goes down significantly. This is still enough for quite a number of applications, but we think that because of the different size of the PLA particles and the PHA and the different properties, this abrasion resistance does not continue when we start to blend with PLA. Then we also had a look at flexibility. So here we compared once again a pure type of PHA, which is PHBV. So this is one of the types of polyhydroxyalkanoates. And we also blended this with PLA. And from these tests, we noticed quite a few things. So first of all, PLA in general is stiffer than PHBV. So if we apply a coating of PHBV, it will definitely be more flexible when comparing similar formulations. As I mentioned before, PHAs have excellent biodegradation, so we see this once again on the full coating as well, that we have very fast degradation if we do a sol burial test. Another advantage of PHBV compared to PLA is that the migration of plasticizer is definitely decreased, so it really holds the plasticizer very well. It can also be easily blended with PLA. This can be done for two reasons. One of them is mainly to decrease the cost of the entire product, but also just to increase the biodegradation of a PLA itself. Because the PHBV also has less need for migration, it also can take more plasticizer without just falling apart or not giving a smooth surface. The only disadvantage, a big disadvantage of this PHBV, is that it really tends to stick to itself, so it needs a really specific attention when making the formulations. And then finally, one of the final tests we did is also look at the durability of one of these prints that we made. So here in the BioOnTop project, we made a screen print on a cotton fabric. And we looked what happens if we wash this fabric. So here on the right, you can see the original. And on the left, you can see what happens if we wash these kind of fabrics at 30 degrees. You can see there are some slight differences in color. This is because on the one hand, we used the different types of plasticizer, but also added some cross-linkers. But in general, we can conclude that the washing resistance is not great, but this is kind of expected because the biodegradation mechanism involves hydrolysis of the PHA, which is usually not what you want when you want to go for a good washing resistance. So to conclude, with these PHA plastisol coatings, they are very promising. They have good properties. We are still looking into possibilities as well with barrier properties, especially in the BioOnTop project. And in general, we can also say that if we have these plastisol coatings, that we also always have to make a trade-off. So either we go for something that is very biodegradable, so where we can, for example, select some bio-based fillers, specific plasticizers, coalescents, or we go something that is more durable, in which we add, for example, a larger amount of cross-linkers, different types of plasticizers, and in that way obtain a PHA coating that is more durable, but also, as a side note, biodegrades less. So this really allows for product-specific solutions that can be done with these types of coatings. So I want to thank all of you for your attention, and if you have any questions, then feel free to ask me now. Or send me an email. My credentials are right here in the middle of the slide.
Thank you, Willem. Actually, we already have two questions. Which plasticizer did you use in your experiment?
So we used like I said, we used different types of plasticizers depending on the application, but I cannot share which plasticizers exactly.
Okay, thank you. And do you have any food grade solvent to recommend to dissolve PHA?
With solvents, I assume the question means some organic solvent that can be used to dissolve PHA?
I think so.
Yeah. So this is something we will look into in a different project. So we have the Preserve project as well, which is also a European project, in which a partner called AIMPLUS will look into the possibilities of dissolving PHA in different types of solvents and the compatibilities. But this is still research that is ongoing. So if you are interested in this kind of application, then I would definitely follow the Preserve project.
Oh, yeah. And there is another one. What is the target application of such textile coating, and what is possible time of usage with regard to biodegradability?
So possible applications. So here at Santex Bell, we generally think of the other way around. So we see which are the properties, and then we look at possible applications. But for these types of coatings, we can, for example, go for some either bio-based composites, but we can also look at, for example, textile-based packaging. One of the examples in BioOnTop is, for example, a shopping bag, but also reusable food wraps, where these PHA coatings can help with the barrier properties, or can be used as, for example, an adhesion layer, where we use the PLA to adhere two substrates together. Another option is to, for example, use this in paper coating, but this still has to be looked into. When we look at textiles, then, like I said, one of the applications is in bio-based composites, but we can also look at, for example, bio-based wallpapers and many more applications.
Okay, thank you so much, Willem. It was a pleasure to get those insights on the advance of PHA coatings and also at the BioNTOP. And also some of the partners that are here today for the workshop are involved in the PRESERVE project that you mentioned. So it's another opportunity to follow more European projects.
Definitely.